Hey everybody, welcome to Sound Bombing. I created this show for people who want to experience a radical, life-changing journey through the sounds of my diverse guests. I hope that each sound you hear on this show will strengthen your faith, encourage your dreams, and challenge you to awaken the greatness within you.
This is a journey into sound. A journey which along the way will bring to you new color, new dimension, new values, and a new experience.
LaMarr D.
Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, wherever you are, whatever coast that you're on, whatever island that you're on, whatever continent you're on. This is me, your friend, Dr. LaMarr Darnell Shields, the host of Sound Bombing. And as always, I'm so honored that you decide to hang out with us. If you're new to the show, thank you for joining us. If you're old to the show, you know what's about to happen. Yes, we have to do our breathing exercise. So find yourself in a comfortable position. And we're going to start out with our three breaths. So here we go. Inhale. And then exhale. Two more times. Inhale. And then exhale. One more time. We're going to go deep. We're coming from the belly. Inhale. And then exhale. Sound bombers, what is that called? That is called the breath of life. And what that says is that we are here and I am here. And again, I am so honored that you decide to show up. I don't care how you're listening, on your tablet, on your phone, in your car, in your house, on the radio. I don't care what platform that you're on. But what I do care about is that you are staying safe, that you're protecting yourself as much as possible, that you're quarantined, that you're physically distancing yourself from individuals, that you're checking on your elders, that you're eating whole foods, that you're drinking a lot of water, and that you're keeping your hands clean, and you're keeping COVID away from other people, and you're wearing your mask because you are not only just protecting me, you are protecting yourself. So thank you for that service announcement from LaMarr Darnell Shields. In today's world, hate seems to be the dominating factor in everything. People are holding on to grudges and prejudices. Disasters seem to be happening one after the other. We just can't seem to catch a break with all this is going on. We need to spread love around more than ever. So when was the last time you thought about the fact that you are a member of the human species first and foremost? For most of us, this aspect of our identity is not front and center. More relevant are things like gender, ethnicity, nationality, religion, political party, sports team. Can we please get some sports back? And all other group memberships, large and small. Not only do we stake our identity and often also our sense of self-worth in these groups, but we tend to be more helpful towards those who belong to them, often at the expense of those who do not. We have multiple opportunities to spread love every single day to everyone we encounter. However, we have to first feel love and understand our value. Then we have to be the love from the inside out before we can spread it around to others, because you can't give what you don't have. And although acts of kindness, certainty apply to spreading love, it should expand even more than that. This means spreading out into the community, city, state, country, mountain, hemlock, and the world which we live in, wherever you are. Think about your life right now. I want you to pause for a second and just think about your life. Do you feel love for yourself? Do you feel love around you? Are you being love as you go through each day? And are you spreading love at home, in your workplace, in your neighborhood, in your barrio, in your community, or perhaps in larger areas of services, in your church, in your mosque, or your synagogue? It is our core responsibility for living in the world at this time. And if you look at your own life and the lives of people around you, it is obvious that more love is needed. And as the great Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. So our next guest, they're going to talk about love because they're the founders of Love in America and are on a mission to show us to begin today by paying attention to how you are living your life. They will share stories about living through love and will remind us that love is our true essence. Something inborn in you, ingrained in you, is in your DNA and is the only thing that can ever bring you happiness, peace, joy, and abundance, and the kind of life you truly want to experience. Who am I talking about? Scotte and Toni Burns. They are storytellers from Deadwood, South Dakota, married for 37 years. Some people can't do 37 things in 37 minutes. So 37 years, they've taken their own love on the road, traveling, and literally people, listen to what I'm saying, literally traveling throughout America by motorcycle to connect with Americans of every race, status, lifestyle, faith, and age to help us overcome our perceived differences by discovering commonalities and other of great loves of America, people, places, and passion in diverse American cultures. They collect and share these stories of love with the hope of uniting Americans in America. Their goal is to upend stereotypes, bridge red, blue, brown, tolerance, heal a nation, inspire curiosity, reconnect through the engaging stories of love and storytellers throughout what they actually do. And so I'm so honored that Scotte is joining us in the studio, and somebody is next to Scotte. Toni is joining us in the studio as well. Welcome to Sound Bombing. How are you all doing today?
We are fabulous, and that is without a doubt the most gracious introduction we have ever received. I want to sit back and listen to us now.
I know. I don't even want to talk now.
Don't you want to know, like, who in a ham sandwich is he talking about? Like, he could not be talking about him. And I forgot they do all this on the great Harley Davidson, which is a serious motorcycle. They probably just drive right past me. I'm a bootleg motorcycle. Actually, I'm not a motorcycle. I have an e-bike. I'm a bougie rider. So I have an e-bike, Scotte and Toni. So when I'm going up these hills, I love it. I see people going, they just going hard, going hard, going hard. And then Toni and Scotte, you know what I do? I just press my button like, and go up the hill. So first of all, how are you all doing? How are you dealing with the pandemic? How is this? How are you holding up?
Well, the funny thing is the frustrating thing is that we can't get out right now and do what we love to do. Mm-hmm. That's the most frustrating, because trying to connect with people, I don't care what race, culture, ethnicity, faith, economic status you are. When someone approaches you with a mask.
Yeah, I'm so glad you said that. It used to be people like look like me, you know, brown people to walk with a mask. Now we're scared of everybody. Like, you don't even know who the people are behind. Like, and there's a metaphor, you know, Paul Lawrence Dunbar wrote a poem called We Wear the Mask. And there's almost like a metaphor about this hiding of the mask. I ran into a lady in a health food store who I've been knowing my whole life, took my children through their rites of passage ceremony, my daughters. And I'm talking to her, and she did not know who I was. And I was like, we call her name is Mama Rashida. Mama Rashida, you don't. She says, no, I don't. She said, but your eyes look familiar. I'm like, my eyes look familiar. And so you are right. I don't care what race, culture, class you are from. This thing is wearing a mask. And it's almost like a metaphor of hiding behind things. So are you all safe? How are you all? You look a little happier. Maybe you all like being quarantined. 37 years, you all might like to be quarantined with one another. Some people, we don't like being quarantined.
We have been alone together before.
For very long periods of time.
So. Yeah, the environment up here is a little challenging because, of course, mm-hmm. Deadwood is a tourist town. And so we've got folks from all over the United States coming, and they have not come here to socially distance and wear masks.
No.
They're here to drink and gamble. And so coming from our point of view, you know, which is based in community and love and respect for others, and that's been a little challenging.
It has been because my day job, I manage a Starbucks, mm-hmm. and I'm the only, but we're inside of a casino. And my department is the only one that still wears masks. It's very frustrating.
This is crazy. So tell our listeners where you all are joining us in the bomb shelter. Where are you currently?
We are in Deadwood, South Dakota, which is in the heart of the Black Hills on the western side of South Dakota, mm-hmm. right almost all the way to the Wyoming state line.
Yep.
And let me just tell you, I'm so excited to finally meet you all. My producer, Nicole Klimparka, was so excited. Don't forget to call them. I know we had to reschedule. But what I'm excited about is I have this goal. before I turn 50, and I have about a year, some change left, all right? And my goal is to hit 50 states before I turn 50. And ironically enough, and I don't believe in coincidences or coinky dinkies, as some people say, that you all are near four of the two states that I need to mention, that I need to visit. You mentioned one of them, South Dakota and Wyoming. The other two is Montana. So yes. It's South Dakota, North Dakota, Montana, and Wyoming. And so Those are the four states. So now I have some people that I can go and visit and hang out with. And I love it. And I love where you all are, because I am so excited to come in that direction. So when this pandemic slows down, well, I may just come in an entire spacesuit. As you can see, I'm rocking my Star Wars.
But I love that. I love the t-shirt.
And I love to be around people that like to give tours. And I'm so excited you all are there. And I'm excited about the story. So let's get down to it.
You got a place to stay, too.
Believe me, I'm open. And she was so excited, you know, when she found out where you live, because that's one of the states that we've been trying to get to. And the fact that what you all do, she sent me tons of questions. She was so excited. She was so bummed that we had to sort of cancel, but I'm glad that we did.
Sorry about that.
But we're here. So tell us what prompted you to begin traveling America to spread the message of love.
Well, that kind of started with a question to us, because we've been married for a long time, and we're not like overly affectionate in public, but we're kind of affectionate in public. And we're always getting that question of, oh, well, how, you guys are so cute. How long have you been married?
Well, and some of that is because of the circles we've tried. We've been in the music business together. We work Renaissance festivals.
Okay.
You know, I was a teacher for 24 years. Okay. So professionally and personally, we've been involved in cultures that are, I would say, kind of liberal left. And so, you know, being monogamous and together for almost four decades and that was kind of anomalous. But yet when we get around, you know, we come up to South Dakota, or we're in a ranch situation, or rodeo, or, you know, biker rallies, you know, which are traditionally a little more towards the right.
Yes.
We commonly were getting from both of these groups this question about what is the secret?
Right.
As if there were some big secret about being happy and loving.
That we're keeping from everybody.
Yeah. We could somehow impart this wisdom to others,
yes,
and that it would make them happy and loving as well. And we knew we didn't have any such answer.
So, but what prompted the travel though? What was the defining moment that you decided that you wanted to get on your Harley, walk, drive?
There was an actual moment where we were walking the dogs, because I've always had dogs, and we're walking the dogs, and Scott asked me, he says, you know, people are always asking us this question, you know, how do you make it work? And he looked at me and I looked at him and he said, so how do we make it work? And I went, and he did the same thing. And we decided we didn't know. We just did. And so we figured who did know was going to be.
We knew who would know.
Right. Which was going to be
America.
Because there's so many people. I mean, love is such a unifying factor. And so we started out with sort of that romantic, let's find the best love story. And go ahead.
And we knew how to find America was the way we've always found her before, and that was by motorcycle.
There's a very different way of seeing the country on a bike than on a car.
So what was the very first state that you traveled to on this journey?
Is that New Mexico?
Well, at the time we were living in Colorado. I was a teacher in the Denver metro area.
You're naming all my favorite states. You're naming all Colorado. I was my last trip was to New Mexico. You're naming all my favorite places. I'm surprised you didn't drive past me on the highway. Why did you throw any love my way? Did you not throw any love my way, brother? Why?
It was in our wake. Just breathe deep in our wake.
Okay. There we go.
No, actually, what you just said is funny, because it was a perfect segue, because we headed from Colorado into New Mexico, and our first interview was actually at
accidental
the Mabel Dodge Lujan House in Taos, New Mexico. We were supposed to interview a couple, the longest married couple at the Taos Pueblo, and if you're familiar with the Taos area, Taos Pueblo is the longest continuously occupied building in North America. Mm-hmm. There have been people living there for over 900 years.
Wow.
And the Tewa people in the Taos Pueblo have one industry. They've made themselves their business. They basically sell their lives. They put themselves on display for tourists. Mm-hmm. And so the front rooms of most of the home units, I guess, condos, I guess, in the Taos Pueblo are the kind of viewing rooms. And, you know, people will come out and, you know, it's almost like, and I don't mean this in a derogatory sense, but they really have made themselves an observation point, kind of a human zoo.
It's a human zoo.
And we were curious, you know, when you break that down and you start looking at what makes life here worth living, what do you love? How is, you know, this way that you're living affecting the ways that you live and love here? When we first went in, the couple that we were supposed to interview, the fellow had just broken his leg the day before and had been through surgery and was in no condition to do an interview with us.
Yeah, we were told he was cranky.
He was cranky.
Yes. He did not want to talk about love right there.
Yeah.
Let's talk about something else. Let's talk about pain.
We went to the tourism office, which is mostly, you know, it's a very, I want to say, homogenous sort of. When you picture American tourists, these are the people that are showing up in this line. And the Teo woman who's at the counter buying tickets or selling tickets and giving information and whatnot, she's not looking at anyone.
$15, thank you.
We come up to the line, we hand her a card, and we say, hi, we were here to interview. You know, we talked to the governor of the Taos Pueblo, and we were here to interview this couple, and that's not going to happen. We're here to find out what you love, what makes life here worth living. We're ignorant. We don't know anything about the culture, so please forgive us. Educate us.
We walk into every situation like that. We don't know nothing.
It's amazing how many people want to help you when you say, I'm kind of dumb here. Can you help me out? And so we asked her this question. We gave her one of our cards and we say, we collect love stories and we want to hear yours. This woman stopped what she was doing.
A lot.
And she took her glasses off and she looked at us again and she said,
what do you do?
You do what? And we explained again and she put the entire tourist line on hold while she started calling all of her friends to find us someone to talk to. Because what we've discovered is when you ask people, not who did you vote for, where are you going shopping, what kind
what's
of
your religion,
you like? What do you love? Tell me about your life. People love to tell you about their love and they'll go out of their way to do it. And all those barriers between this white middle-aged biker couple from South Dakota and this Tewa grandmother in Taos Pueblo, all that stuff falls away.
It went away.
And you find that there's this common humanity between you. And we've found that with street artists in East Detroit, with ranchers in Montana, with military naval bases in Virginia.
With megachurch builders.
Megachurch builders, hippie communes, all over the United
Buddhist
States.
Buddhist priests.
You get to that question, what do you love? And all of a sudden, you're human together.
Yeah.
Well, I love that. And I know you sort of document this through your docu-series, Tales from the Heart and America Love Stories, and then that Love in America, the program that you host. How are you actually, with the docuseries, how are you actually documenting this? Are you writing this stuff down? Are you taking a record? Are you just taking a camera? How are you literally documenting everything?
Pretty much everything. We write, we take notes as we go, but we also do the camera. It's not really a reality show so much as, well, no, kind of is. Go ahead. You better hit that one. He's our camera guy. He's our editor.
Yeah, we've been through a plethora of equipment, but we're down to two iPhones, a DSLR, and a Mac.
How many of those things have you dropped while traveling, man?
Oh, all of them.
Okay.
I can't tell you how many pieces of gear skidded across highways in Texas.
I can only imagine.
Trying to weigh him down.
So you use a variety of modalities to collect these stories.
Absolutely.
We do. And we produce, we have three different series on PRX, the Public Radio Exchange. Mm-hmm. We do our own.
Which I love. I got a chance to listen to one. Which I'm a huge NPR, PRX, storytelling. All of those things that nerdy things are in my life. I love all of that. I love capturing stories. That's why I was really excited about you. And we're going to talk about how they can find your stuff. But I want to back up for a second. What are some of the most interesting or intriguing stories you've encountered since you started this journey together?
Well, one of my favorites was one where I jumped out of a moving vehicle to grab the interview.
Uh-huh.
We obviously.
What are you now, a stunt woman?
Downtown Minneapolis. All I had to say was I won't go through the whole story, but we encountered this couple while we rented a car because sometimes in the inner city, we don't like riding the motorcycles. And we encountered this couple walking out of an alley downtown Minneapolis. And I said, boy, they would have been interesting to talk to. And she says, yes, they would. She was gone.
I waited for a stop sign. I don't want to think I dropped
you. Rolled.
So now tell me, was their story intriguing? Now, what you did was intriguing.
It was worth jumping out of a car.
It was worth jumping out of a car.
This looked like a Minneapolis, you know, sort of downtown little yuppie couple. They're wearing pink shirts because they just got done with the run.
Little runners things. Yeah. The numbers pinned on them.
She had this cute little ponytail, and he was this like really buff, you know, bodybuilder mm-hmm. kind of guy that's tatted up to his neck. But they were just so cute, you know?
And so she asked one of our icebreaker questions. Mm-hmm. You know, we have questions that we just start a conversation with, and usually we're recording.
With a couple, it's usually.
But she just says, you know, typical sort of generic. Yeah, how did you meet? It's just one. You know.
So what does the average person say when you walk up to them? Because I do some man, quote unquote, man on the street stuff, and people look at me like I'm crazy. What are some things that people say to you, like off the cuff, like as soon as you walk up with the camera, what have you? Even if you start with the icebreaker question, what are some immediate responses?
Well, I want to finish with that one because I think it'll address both of your questions.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
She asked this fellow, you know, how did you meet? And he said, "Well, I was a meth dealer and she was a junkie, and I traded a guy half a gram of meth for her phone number."
What?
Turns out,
yeah.
Yeah,
not what I expected.
Is it okay to record this? He said, "Oh yeah, I paid for this." Long story, as short as we can make it.
Yeah.
Turns out after he got her phone number from trading half a gram of methamphetamines for her number, he ended up getting popped and going to prison mm-hmm. a couple of weeks after that. She was so taken with him and his story and saw something in him. She hired an attorney and stayed and waited for him while he was in prison for three years. And when he moved out, her father allowed him to move in under the condition that he not ask her to marry him until he was out for the same amount of time he was in.
And 6 months later, his dad said, that's fine, you
go right on ahead.
So this couple are now youth pastors.
Had their first.
Yes.
They've had their first baby. I mean, it's not what you expected. Yep. I love those stories.
I mean, jumping out the car, I'm already imagining you jumping out the car, rolling around, you know, Scott turning around, like you guys are like FBI agents or something and trying to track down some terrorists or something in Minnesota. You just, you know, got somebody. And so now to see that this story turned out that way. So here's another interesting question. So for you all. Is there, because I'm going to speak for my culture of people, is there a group of people that you walked up to and they looked at you like you crazy? Like, I'm giving you an example. I represent two African-American Latino cultures. So cultures that I'm around all the time. I can't imagine, and I know sometimes walking up to people that look like me with a camera, asking some questions, my own people look at me like, fool, if you don't get out my face with that camera. Is there a group of people that look at you, it might maybe gender, women, age group, that they say, is this for real? Am I being punked? Is there something wrong? Because sometimes I approach people differently based on what I think that they might say. Right. Are you learning anything different about how you approach maybe different cultures or gender or how people may look, you know, from may having religious garb or cultural garb around them?
Well, the first question is, everybody looks at us like that.
We are in a unique position of having, and it's a blessed position of being able to put ourselves in the position of being the other.
Always.
Almost everywhere we go, you know, we are of a culture that if we just stayed in South Dakota and just attended bike rallies and stuff, heck, we'd be fine. But we've found that our comfort zone is not comfortable. Mm-hmm. And so as we found ourselves in, you know, with Vietnamese boat builders or the Wiccan community in Memphis or, you know, inner city Detroit or the Rosebud Reservation, when we come in as the other, we found out that it's so easy to get to know people if you just come in and say, we don't know anything.
Yeah.
You
know, Teach us. Talk to us. We're ignorant.
And I love it because because in my research standpoint, you want to come in not as an observer. You want to participate. You want to be a part of the culture. You just happen to have the camera rolling and having a conversation. When you come in with this sometimes elitist or you try to bring people down, I think people tend to shy away. I remember doing a photo shoot in this community here. It was for a magazine. And the guy that was shooting me was a white guy. And, you know, I was dressed up. We pulled up in a nice car. And I said to him, I said, he started filming. I said, hold up for a second. So I said, I need to go talk to these brothers. And I'm not saying Christian brothers. I'm talking brothers, black guys that look like me. I said, I need to go over and talk to these guys who are playing basketball, because as soon as I get out the car, and I, the white guy with the camera with all the bells and whistles, I said, they're going to ask questions, they're going to come around, or they might not care. So I went over there, and one of the guys said, man, I was wondering what was going on out here, man. I was wondering what you guys, and because you're coming into somebody's space, and that could have been a group of white kids, that could have been a group of, you know, Jewish kids, because I live in a Jewish community. It could have been anyone, but I like to respect the space of people. And I know culturally where I come from, when you see people with cameras, when you see people with still cameras, or you see with video cameras, there's a level of being a little nervous, because you know, we're used to, we don't like when people come into our spaces. And so that's why I asked that question. I love how you responded to that, because I know some of my listeners are thinking, all right, some of my listeners that might look like me, like these white folks just popping up and showing. And but I love that you named a group of people and you said, I've come into these spaces, and I'm learning as I'm coming along in there as a person that I don't know. I'm asking questions. But what you're learning, what are some of the unifying factors that you're discovering from all walks of life of people that you're coming in contact with?
I want you to hold that thought and respond to that. But I want to piggyback on what you just said, because the cameras come out last.
Yes.
Absolutely. And the most acute example of that is when we were on the Rosebud Reservation. The Rosebud Reservation in southern South Dakota is per capita the poorest area in the United States. Mm-hmm. And camera crews, especially Anglo camera crews that end up on the Rosebud Reservation, they commonly are producing what people on the res call poverty porn.
Say that again, Scott. You called it what?
It's called poverty porn.
Poverty porn. Wow.
They're there to document these poor Native American cultures that are there.
These poor, sad people.
And oftentimes show themselves, whether it's consciously or not, as the sort of saviors, you know, the guiding, we're going to expose this so that other people like us can show their magnanimity. Well, to the Lakota, it's deeply insulting. You know, that's coming from the very same people that have forced them onto the reservation to begin with.
Yeah.
And so going on to the Lakota, Anglos going on to the Lakota reservation.
It's actually kind of dangerous with the camera.
Yeah, it's not wise.
No.
And because we had set up, we'd established a relationship with a fellow named Greg Graycloud. And Greg's organization, Weecha Ogli, is retraining men who have been court remanded from the reservation police and justice system for domestic violence. He's reteaching them how to love by pairing them with abused horses.
He's teaching
them empathy through an abused spirit that can respond in no other way than defense or love.
And that's such a great mechanism. There's a huge body of research around having animals as a part of a therapy process. I've seen that not with people who are abusers, but I've seen it with some at-risk children who are very violent, and they get an opportunity to take care and love an animal that might have been hurt, thrown out, or what have you. So that's a great. I actually visited, and I talked about it in my book, What I Learned in the Midst of Chaos. I visited a reservation in Arizona, I cannot think of the name of this nation. They're a nation, the Otham nation, Tohono Otham nation, and they're in Arizona. And I learned so much about that culture of people. I spoke to students, I spoke to family members, I participated in some of the games. And so you're right, you know, you bring in on people who we clearly know exterminated us. And then now we want you to bring cameras. So I really appreciate you sharing that. But that porn piece, oh man, that just hit my heart just to hear that. Because even when I stepped on the res, I have not been, you know, Scott and Toni been intimidated too often. But walking on a reservation, I was not prepared for what I had witnessed. But the beauty underneath the ashes of what has happened to this group of people really blew me away. And so my other part of the question was, what are some unifying factors that you're seeing on reservations, communities, mosques, synagogues, neighborhoods, barrios, slums? What are the unifying factors that you're seeing this permeates, or the threads is running through all of these places?
Honestly, love. I mean, one of the things we love, in some ways we love differently, but everybody loves something, whether it's
something,
a parent
or
a place or what they do. And once you can start with that, once you can say, what do you love? it is mind-boggling to me how much we have in common. I got to I'll try to make it quick because I'm terrible at quick stories, but I'll try to make it quick. We interviewed a couple when we were still focusing more on romantic love and not as much on the universal on love. We had interviewed a white, way upper middle class, conservative Christian couple that built mega churches in New Mexico. That's Roswell. What they did. Roswell, New Mexico. And they were, I don't think they could even stand straight. They leaned so far to the right.
super gracious to
but
us.
Very gracious amazing. People, really wonderful. And they told us their story about how they met in church and how she was the band leader and he was the minister and they fell in love and their main focus was their faith. And it, rather than proselytizing, they live their faith by example to the community mm-hmm. around them rather than saying, you know, this is right, this is wrong. Then we met another couple in Virginia Beach, Virginia, who were biracial, homosexual females, mm-hmm. 15-year difference. They were raising
sort of lower middle class,
raising a Down syndrome child. And they spoke about how they met in choir, how faith is their foundation.
They didn't want to proselytize.
They didn't want to proselytize, but they're living their life by example. You could have switched the scripts of what they said and never known it was two different couples. That, to me, is part of the core of what we do, is that, okay, if these guys passed each other on the street, would they talk to each other? Or would they just keep going on their ways going, oh, I've got nothing in common with them and they've got nothing in common with us, when they are basically, in so many ways, deep at the core, the same people.
The most important thing we have in common is love.
Is love.
And that's people's recognition of that is almost like a light bulb going off. When we have, we oftentimes joke, because we have a very small audience, we oftentimes joke that we're not good mass marketers, but we're aces at converting people one at a time. Mm. Because when we can sit down and talk to people one-on-one, we share these stories with them and we share the experiences we've had with different demographics and cultures around the U.S. and had those same epiphanal moments mm-hmm. with all of them.
Yeah.
When we got to the point of saying, what is it that you love? And they start telling the story. All these differences between us, mm-hmm. they vanish.
Yeah, and that's what we always say. We've got some tough discussions to make in this country and this world.
We've been ignoring them for too long.
And I'm sure, go ahead, I'm sorry, you were about to finish.
Well, I'll make it quick. We've got some really tough discussions we have to have, but we're not going to start them if we begin from a point of difference.
So then with that being said, how can we change our mindset to one that is more open to love?
Talk to each other.
Well, and not only that, you know,
listen to each other.
This past summer, we did part of our tour from Birmingham to Montgomery and to Selma and tried to trace some of the history and the legacies of that area. Mm-hmm. And one of the fellows we interviewed at Kelly Ingram Park in Birmingham on the corner of where the 16th Street Baptist Church
is. And you are all in my neighborhood. Dude, why have I not seen? Because my daughter and my son did the same thing like last year. Maybe I did. I'm like, who are these white folks driving down here? Maybe I did see you. Maybe I wasn't spreading any love when I saw you. So, because you in my backyard, I was just there, man. I was just there. Go ahead.
That's awesome.
Now, there were two city workers, just street workers, in the corner of the park. And, you know, we talked to everybody. So we stopped and said, you mind if we ask you some questions? And that's when we asked, you know, is it okay if we bring the camera out? And if not, that's cool. We just want to know what you think.
Yeah, we've had some discussions. Darnell, we never turned the camera on.
Yeah, Darnell, one of these two fellas, we asked that same question that you just asked. And he said what Toni said. He said, ask questions.
And listen.
But yeah, the two keys there is, first of all, you got to listen to the answer. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't feel good because you asked the right question. You feel informed and educated because you listen to the response.
Yeah.
So you're talking about asking questions and you're talking about answering, having a good response. But what are some of the barriers of spreading love that you've encountered or that the average person could encounter? What are some barriers that you're seeing that people are saying? Because you're talking about love, but what are some things that they said are some of the barriers that might exist?
That's funny, because when you said that, it occurred to me that it's the same. People are always asking us for advice, and we don't ordinarily give advice. But we can tell you, you know, how to make yourself happy, but we can tell you how to make yourself unhappy. And it's the same thing about setting up barriers, and that's judgments. Mm-hmm. Preconceptions and judgments. when we compare ourselves to other people and say, you know, if my life was like that, or, you know, they have this big secret, or, you know, we're comparing where we are in our lives to where other people are, it's a recipe for unhappiness, because you're always going to find places where you feel like you're lacking, depending on who you're comparing yourself to. And judging people ahead of time because of their faith or their ethnicity or the area where they live.
Socioeconomic, we're getting a lot of, we got a lot of.
Yeah, I can't tell you how, and I found myself guilty of this down south. I hear that southern drawl, that southern accent, mm-hmm. and I start drawing conclusions on a person's intellectual capability. Mm-hmm. And I had to recognize that in myself and say, just because this person grew up here and they have this particular cant in their language, there's no bearing on their IQ.
Right.
And that was borne out, you know, so I think the short answer to your question is it's judgments and preconceptions and biases.
And I'm in this space every day having this conversation, Scotte and Toni, with educators. The bulk of my work when I'm not on the road lecturing is I'm talking about inequity and I'm talking about equity and I'm talking about implicit bias and microaggression. And I love, Scotte, where you said I had to admit to my own truth that I'm listening to this Southern drawl and I'm having these thoughts about what it is based on history. Based on history I've read, based on things that people might have said. And I think that that's where the level of growth is. And I agree with what you said, Toni, is having the conversation, but then also listening. Since you were talking about being in the South, what state left the biggest impact on you?
In the South or in the U.S.?
Just in the U.S. What state that had like the biggest impact on you?
I love Mississippi. That was one of my favorites.
Except for the roads in Jackson.
God. Oh, God, that was awful.
Shout out to my friend who's the superintendent of Jackson and the mayor of Jackson. I'm glad you guys said that. We gotta work on those roads. We got to work on those roads. You all hear my people down in Jackson. But what state had the greatest impact?
And I would only, and we're probably going to come up with different answers because we always do from each other. But mine was Mississippi, or actually Bama. When we went into Mobile, the warmth of the people. I mean, we were, like I said, we're always the other, and we were accepted into communities where we did not belong with the most open arms. It was incredible. I mean, I just wanted to hug everybody. Can't now, but
and it's so interesting, Toni, that you mentioned two states that has a horrible civil rights record, a horrible record of treating not only just blacks, but gays and lesbians, LGBTQ plus community, poor people. And it's interesting that you said Mississippi and Alabama, because I know somebody is listening and like, they probably cringe like when you said Mississippi and Alabama, but you drove around, had conversations, and you got something different than somebody else might've got because you spent time in space and you listened to individuals. And you learn, because somebody might be listening and say, Mississippi, Alabama? But I, too, going to Alabama sort of felt this level. Mississippi, you know, I struggle a little bit because just the history and things like that. But Alabama, I'm seeing this level of growth. I'm seeing things change. But I like your honesty, because there's some people might say, yeah, but I can see that. I can see that there, even though there's this history that exists. What about you, Scotte? What state had the biggest impact on you? She mentioned two.
The stories that we tell, as Toni said, we started out telling all couple stories, but we've expanded into, because we knew that people's loves were more than their relationships with each other. They were also loves of what we called loves of place, purpose, and one another. And so the places that had the biggest impact on me weren't from the stories or the people that we encountered, but the places where they were living, a sort of human geography factor. So I would have to say Oregon, the Oregon coast. Riding the Oregon coast is an experience that every human being should be required to have at least once in their lives. Similar to Glacier National Park in Montana.
Yeah, and I've never heard anybody talk about the Oregon coast, riding the Oregon. That's new to me.
You've been Big Sur?
Nope.
You got to.
You know what Big Sur?
Put that on your list.
Do you have a mental image of what Big Sur looks like?
Oh, yeah, I do. Like, I'm really into, topography, landscape, national parks.
Yep.
All of those things.
Picture Big Sur going on for about 150 miles.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
That's the Oregon coast.
Just if God wanted to wake you up and say, this is what's possible in creation.
This is what happens in the next
what
world.
It is. Okay. And I think upstate New York, the Hudson Valley was a
nice. Okay. So two very different, and I'm glad you all had two very different places. So now let's put our, let's use this metaphor. Let's park the motorcycle. Let's put the emergency brake on and put our hazard lights on. How have the two of you been able to keep love alive through the years?
Oh, us?
Yes.
Well, we haven't killed each other.
Like liberty, you know.
Well, and the other thing that I think it's just, in many ways, I could spread this out to the rest of the world, is it's mutual respect. I have done some really stupid and crazy things in my life. And my husband in, 37, married, 40 together, has never looked at me and said, no, you can't do that. He respects my opinion. He has said, I'm really uncomfortable with that, honey.
And I'm sure his voice went up. What is about our voice going high? Like my daughter was like, why does your voice go up like that when you do that? I'm sure, I just pictured his voice going up another octave when you said that.
But he's never said no. So I think that part is a huge piece of it. There's things that on the road, which was really interesting, that after all these decades of being married, that I don't want to say changed our relationship, but definitely expanded it, so that we're going, oh, wow, I didn't think of it that way. And then we start talking, going, oh, yeah, we didn't think of it that way. And and that's why I'm saying it's not just talking, it's listening. Because if you listen to people, even people you don't agree with, and we try to stay really neutral, but there's people out there I'm just going, what the heck is wrong with you?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you listen and they also listen, it is amazing the commonalities that you can find.
Scott, what about you? I'm sorry, Toni.
I was going to say, I don't know. What I was going to ask him the same question.
There's something else that grows out of mutual respect for another person, and that's the ability to learn to see the world through their eyes. And I love the way the world looks through her eyes.
Oh, I like how she's looking at your eyes right now.
She's always upbeat. She's got a great sense of humor. She's open to people. She's the extrovert and our people person between us, where I'm sort of the focus introvert.
Forces. Yeah.
She gives me the opportunity to see the world in a better light.
Okay. Well, speaking of the world in a better light, I actually came across this piece of artwork that I love, and I shared it with a group of people, and it's a painter that's basically saying, while I'm sitting here painting the world is burning down. And so you're seeing this pandemic internationally, you're seeing these racial movements across the globe, not only just here in America, not only just Black Lives Matter in this country, but across the country. What are some of your thoughts about what's happening right now as it relates to not only just these movements, these racial movements, this racial uprising and this pandemic and this lack of healthcare, and we don't know what's gonna happen with our children when they go back to school. What are your thoughts about what's happening right now? And what do you want people to walk away with from the work that you're doing, that they might not be, that they might miss in all of the facade of what's taking place right now in our country and countries abroad as well?
Take that first.
I can take it first. Okay. He's the deeper thinker, so I'm a little bit more surface thinking. Mm-hmm. The way I look at it is there's some really intense and some really negative things going on, but I'm a constant optimist. I think they're good.
Me too.
I totally think they're good. I think that everything that's going on with Black Lives Matter and the racial, we need a shakeup for things to get better. Things don't get, I don't mean violent. I mean an awareness. And that's something that overall we tend to lack, because we live in our own little worlds with our own little groups and subsets of culture. And we walk through the life thinking, oh, this is all normal, without really opening our eyes and going, okay, here's the reality. And with art, with us, with love, starting there doesn't mean we end there. It's a place to start so we can start talking about some really fundamental issues that are going on, that are wrong, that are difficult, and they're difficult to talk about. And especially as a middle-aged white woman, I mean, there's a lot of the white guilt going on. There's a lot of, you can't stop there. You have to talk, you have to understand, you have to listen, you have to communicate. As a positive person, I think that all of these radical changes and some negative changes that are going on now, I think are actually a good thing. I think that this is one of the greatest upheavals that we've been in the middle of in generations. And as difficult as it is, somebody used the expression that it's the death throes of dinosaurs, and that's good. It's painful in the moment
and destroys everything around it, which will grow back.
But it's a good thing, because once we're through the death throes, then the positive, then the good changes can occur.
We're not going to be too far different on that. I'm going to reverse the order of your questions though and answer your second one first. What I'd like people to take away from this is something Juanetha said, again, at Kelly Ingram Park.
Oh, at Kelly Ingram Park,
she said love, because we ask people to define love. You know, love is, and it's funny to see the hemming and hawing and people trying to go, I've never had to put it in words before. What is it? Juanetha told us what it wasn't. And it's something I think people should take away. Love is not comfortable. Mm-mm. Love is hope, love is promise, love is strength, love is, you quoted King, that line is our credo. Mm-hmm. It's part of the guiding principle that we operate under in what we do. Love is all these things, but love is not comfortable. Mm-mm. And reason being, because when you truly love someone, you can be honest with them. And these times that we're living in right now are forcing people to be honest. Mm-hmm. They're forcing people to say, I've had enough of seeing people who look like me beaten by authority, held down, of seeing the results of redlining still affecting where people can live.
Yeah.
It's forcing, you know, this couple, was it in St. Louis, this white couple that drew their guns on the protesters?
Oh. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's a form of honesty. No, I don't want to see it, and that's ugly. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to change your heart. I'd at least like to see somebody come in and disarm you. The woman's got her finger on the trigger and she's pointing it at his head. And there's something in me that's going, what am I hoping happened to him? Honestly. Because
you have to be,
these situations are forcing us to be uncomfortable. It's forcing people to be honest and say, I've had enough. No, I don't like the color that you are. To force people to say, yeah, I've recognized that the police are abusive. We're looking at some ugly truths with one another, but it's only from that point we can start having the conversations that this country should have had generations ago. Yeah. Because as long as we're saying, I don't see color, or, you know, this was over with 1964 Civil Rights Act, or, let's all pretend, you know, you can't fake it till you make it with this stuff.
No.
We have to look each other in the face and say, this is how I feel. This is how my culture, my community feels. This is you that did this. Mm-hmm. We need to talk about this and find a place where we have some common ground. And that's what we're trying to do, is find that place where you can start. Because people across this country are angry. They're confused.
They're
profoundly lonely. Mm-hmm. And it's one thing we found across the country. People are intensely curious about one another because they've forgotten how to connect.
But they don't know how to ask.
But all that stuff, you can bundle it up and set it aside for a minute to discuss once you reach the simple truth that we all love. Mm-hmm. We love our kids, our families, our cultures,
our dogs,
our histories, our dogs, our jobs, our art. There's something in us that loves everyone. And if we can start from that point, then we can say, okay, I love you, just like in a marriage. You have a fight. You never forget, I love you. Mm-hmm. There's nothing in here that's going, I'm not starting from a place of, I want to hurt you. I want to get even with you. No, I love you, and I know you're angry. Tell me why you're angry.
Yeah, change doesn't from comfort.
So we can fix it. Love is not comfortable, and it shouldn't be, or it can't grow.
Right. Well, listening to you all reminds me of my buddy Ali. I want to connect you all. He has a book out in a film called Walking While Black, Love is the Answer. And all it's right. called Love is the Answer. And he started this Love is the Answer movement. And he's out in California. And I am going to, when we finish, I'm going to connect the two of you all, because I love what he's doing. What he's doing is he's connecting law enforcement and folks in these disparate communities who've had bad history with law enforcement. And he's spreading this love and showing his film. And it's been amazing. So since you talk about love and you have a show about love and you travel across the country, do you all have individuals or collective definitions of what love is?
One of my favorite, I like Scotts, Juanita, love is uncomfortable. But I think one of my favorites was just a one really short answer from this delightful young gay man that we
Fargo,
met
in Fargo,
North Dakota, where you don't expect to meet nice young gay people.
Don't you know?
Don't you know?
I love that. When I saw that movie Fargo, I was like, do these people really? I couldn't even take it. Like my daughter and I was like, are they going to talk like this the whole way? I'm like, well, it's people in other places that we don't like the accent. But
yeah,
what was,
they do.
But we love y'all in Fargo, North Dakota, because we want you to keep listening to the show. But what did he say?
All he said is when we asked him to answer the question, love is, he kind of did the same hemming and hawing, and he just looked at us and finally went, love is hope. Mm-hmm. And I went, damn, that's it. Mm-hmm. That's it. It's that hope that yeah.
What about you, Scott?
Well, King said love is the underlying principle of all the world's religions. And mm-hmm. and it is, you know, when we think, and I almost wish he would have used the term faith, because I think there's a important distinction between faith and religion.
Yes.
But our faith in each other, our faith in God, our faith in ourselves are all based, should all be based in love. So, you know, the love is an act of faith.
I love that. I love that. Now, I want our listeners to get in contact with you. How can they follow you all on social media, check out your show, and know about the things you're doing? What's the best way for them to get in contact with you?
The best way is through the website, because mm-hmm. it's got links to everything. Otherwise, I'm going to give you like a 20-minute list of links.
Far be it from us to talk too much.
So what's the site? Leave the website.
So it's www. And it's really simple. loveinamerica.us.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's very simple. Now, it has been a pleasure talking to you all. I can talk to you all forever, but now I got to switch gears and take you to my favorite part of the show. It is called the Super Bomb Questions. And the Super Bomb Questions are a group of several questions that my listeners sent in a while ago, and they always want to know a little more about you all. And so this is going to be kind of fun, because I've never done, Scott and Toni, I've never done it with two people together. So you both are going to have opportunity to answer these questions. So I'm going to throw out a question, and what's going to happen is one of you all will get a chance to cheat. So I'm going to go back and forth. All right. So you can decide who wants to go first. Say, no, I'm just ask the question. You all can decide to go who goes first or second. Okay. All right. So are you ready for the Super Bomb questions?
Absolutely.
All right. So here we go, in no particular order. What is your favorite word?
Wow. Absolutely. It's my favorite word. I use it all the time.
All right. Yes. That's yours. Scott?
I'm kind of a linguophile, because I was an English teacher for 24 years. I just love the way the word indubitably sounds.
Okay, there we go.
It just all trips right off the tongue, makes your lips do funny things.
Indubitably.
Indubitably.
All right. Next question. What's your favorite quote or your favorite Bible verse or a spiritual verse?
My favorite quote actually comes from Eleanor Roosevelt. No one can make you feel inferior without your permission.
Okay. Scott?
You're going to do King.
Wow. There were
It's almost always King.
Either Stephen or Martin.
Yeah, that's true.
Stephen or Martin.
Gosh.
What you got?
There are so many to choose from. I don't know where I would go with that.
What's the first one that came to mind? Like, we always ask that question. We ask, what's your favorite love song? We say, well, what's the first thing that came to mind?
There we go, Toni. Hold him. Hold his feet to the fire.
Wow, I am totally drawing a blank on it.
All right,
I'm gonna draw the later card.
Okay. What's your super?
Passing.
All right, so now we're gonna come to you. What's your superpower?
Making people laugh.
Mm. Yes.
Scott. That was easy for me. Cheering people up, making people laugh.
What you guys got?
When I was a kid, I always thought the greatest superpower to have would be able to know exactly the right thing to say.
Mm. Go ahead, finish
what's
it.
What's yours?
I'm sorry.
What's your superpower?
So what's your superpower?
Oh, you mean currently?
Yeah.
Yes. I'm so glad that you're there to help him along the way.
I would hope it would be teaching.
Teaching. What's your spirit animal?
Otter. Oh,
that's easy.
That's way easy. I'm covered in otters. Yep. All my ink is otters.
Yep.
Both of you all?
Nope.
Mine's
crows.
A crow. Mine's a crow. I love crows.
Okay. Okay. What moves you to tears of joy?
Redemption.
My favorite Bob Marley song. Ooh.
A good redemption story. You know, people that are, and we have a ton of them, people that have been redeemed by love.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's both of y'all. What moves you to tears of sorrow? What moves you to the tears of, did I ask you sorrow or joy?
You just asked us joy.
What moves you to tears of sorrow?
Antipathy.
I was going to say injustice.
I can almost more easily deal with someone that's openly hostile or racist or, you know, if they're wearing it out front, but someone that just doesn't care.
What do you wish you had more time to do?
Spend with Scott.
Aw.
It's true.
Now, what about you? Now he feels like he has to say the same thing. Now you done boxed him in.
I already know how he feels. It's all good.
Yeah. Hopefully I got nothing left to prove, but I'll keep trying.
So what do you wish we had more time to do?
Write. I wish I had more time to write.
What is the book or books you've given most as a gift and why?
Oh, that's easy.
Go ahead.
Jonathan Livingston Seagull by Richard Bach. Okay. I made it a point to make sure that all of my literature classes over the years read that book. And I would have to say, if there is a quote, it's probably going to come from that book. Because, you know, the ability to understand your limitations and then understand how meaningless they are over time is a really important message for people.
Toni, what about you?
Love you forever.
Okay.
It's a kid's book about a little kid that I love you forever. I'll like you for always, forever and always, my baby you'll be. And it's a really short little story about a kid growing up and his mom, and then when she gets and her always rocking him and singing this to him, and then when he gets older, he picks her up and rocks and sings to her in the nursing home. It's a beautiful book. It's absolutely wonderful.
So if you both were in the Mr. or Mrs. America talent competition, what would your talent be?
Have no talent.
Stand up. You could do stand up. What about you, Scott?
What was the question?
What would your talent be?
This is America competition. What would your talent be?
Oh gosh, I'm trying to picture myself in the swimsuit competition. It's not a good image for anybody. I don't know. I used to be pretty good on the spoons, I guess.
Okay, playing the spoons.
He's an ex-musician. He can play the bass.
Oh, there we go.
Don't let him get away that easy.
So, Toni, I guess you would do stand-up comedy.
Yeah, I think that's about it.
Well, listen.
Or what is that called? Plastic? I tend to fall down a lot.
Oh, wow. So, it has been a pleasure talking to you all, spreading love, making me laugh. Sound bombing community, you got to follow them. You got to follow this story. Listen to them. Spread love. I also want to thank my engineer, Alec Blanc, my amazing producer, Nicole Klempaka, who makes all of this happen by sending me some great questions. Supremacy for our theme music, and all of you for listening. Make sure you subscribe. Leave a comment. Stop being stingy. We're on every platform. Share me with your friends. Yes. Share the love, spread the love of sound bombing. If you want to know more about me, you can go to drlds.com. Doctor, that's drlds.com. And as always, believe there's something wonderful is about to happen, that some people miss the message because they're too busy looking for the mess. Thanks for tuning in, and do something for someone other than yourself today. You've been listening to Sound Bombing. Peace. Thanks a lot, Scott and Toni.
Thank you.
Appreciate you all.